I didn't know about the true chamber, and suddenly I was in there, and there was a guy sitting, an Indian man with a candle, and he gave me a flower, and he sang or toned an om. But boy, that really blew my mind, because in that resonating stone chamber, I think I was out of my body. I wasn't ill, I had no accident, nothing like the normal NDE. I was in a tunnel, and I was not moving, I was floating.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Gabriele Heikamp. How are you doing, Gabriele?
I'm fine, thank you. Hope you're too.
I'm doing very good. You're in Germany right now. You are German, and I've had a few people, I guess, from Europe with near-death experiences, but I don't think I've had a channel on from Europe. So I think you might be one of the first on the show. So we're going to talk about your remarkable near-death experience and what that led you to where you are today. And we might do a little bit of a channeling session towards the end of the conversation. So my first question to you is, what was your life like before this near-death experience?
Well, I'm the fifth child of a chief forester, and my first memory starts with 3 years old. I'm sitting in the living room with all my siblings and the parents around, and I'm looking at them, and I'm thinking as a three-year-old. Can you think as a three-year-old? It felt as if the soul just kicked in. I'm looking at them, and the thought was, what am I doing here with these people? And I felt ashamed because I knew this is my family. I shouldn't think like that. So I felt guilty. But from the very beginning, I felt I'm wrongly incarnated. There's something wrong here. I don't want to be here. Then I lost my brother at the age of 16 in a motorcycle accident. I was 12. And well, that opened the door, because I still could feel him around, and I was searching for him. I was riding on the cycle through the woods and looking for the place where he could be, the great beyond, or however this is called. And so my life carried on. In school, they said, this girl has too much fantasy. And I had an invisible friend that was to me like a school kid. And once I always hung out with this kid, was my only friend around 12 years, 13 years after my brother had died. And I always came late home for the supper. So I got rented. And my parents said, where have you been? And I told them a name and said I was with so-and-so, another school kid. And they believed it. And one day I came home late again, and again, the same procedure as every day. My oldest sister was sitting at the table, and she said, oh, you're lying. I saw you in front of the village window shop, and you were alone. So the others couldn't see with whom I was. So I got hit by my father because of the lie. And so I learned very quickly not to talk about these things. And I think I spent a lot of my childhood talking with the invisible. I was playing alone in the bushes in the garden where nobody could see me. So then I started as a graphic designer, because I didn't know what to do else. I wasn't into numbers and mathematics, and all this stuff didn't interest me. As a child, I was only into drawing. I was drawing hieroglyphs as a child.
Wow.
That was remarkable. I still can do that, but I don't understand what I'm drawing. So I thought about becoming an archaeologist or a psychologist. That was interesting to me. But I ended up as a graphic designer. Makes very much sense, because now I know I had one former life as a scribe in Egypt. So that matches perfectly. Mm-hmm. And after I finished college, I got some money from my father to do whatever. I think he tried to test me whether I would put the money in the bank and do something good, in his opinion, with that. And I thought, wow, I'm going on a quest. I'm buying a ticket. I'm flying to India. That's where religion is born. I want to find the purpose of my life, as if it is only there. Okay. You know, thinking is two-dimensional. We're very limited. But I did it. And well, after a while, I landed in the Taj Mahal. And this is a building made of marble. So I think there's a lot of quartz in it, which resonates. Then you have the Jamuna River on the side. And it is also lined true north and south. So that's exactly the criteria where all the ancients build their monuments, on ley lines, using the water, which creates energy, and the resonating quartz in the stone. I've been there during the day and I felt nothing, just some tourist monument with two sarcophagi. And I was disappointed. And at the hostel, I talked to some other backpackers. They told me, oh, you have to go there on full moon night, because then the white marble is reflecting the white light of the moon. And this whole thing looks like a crazy starship that's hovering above the ground. And I thought, oh, that sounds interesting. Okay, let's have a look. And you won't believe it, next night was full moon. So I went there again, less tourists, only two or three people. I entered the same showroom with the two sarcophagi of the presumed Shah of Persia, who ruled there with his wife. And suddenly I discovered that there was a hole in one corner that was leading down to another room. And there was a black hole with a staircase. And I felt a bit scared, but I felt also drawn to it. And I knew I had to go down there, no matter what. Mm-hmm. So my body moved like a robot. I inside, oh no, I don't want to go into this black hole. But I went down there and there was another chamber. Obviously, the one above is some kind of false chamber to distract the grave robbery or something like that. And I didn't know about the true chamber. And suddenly I was in there and there was a guy sitting, an Indian man with a candle. And he gave me a flower and he sang or toned an om. But boy, that really blew my mind, because in that resonating stone chamber, I think I was out of my body. I wasn't ill. I had no accident, nothing like the normal NDE. I was in a tunnel and I was not moving. I was floating. The tunnel was dimly lit and suddenly in front of me, there was a wall. A gigantic monolithic stone wall like you find in Tiwanaku and Pumapunku and all over the world. And on this wall, that's very biblical, there was flaming writing telling me, after I had a life review before, you're not going to die now. Go back to Germany. It's around your corner. The Rosicrucians have the knowledge you seek. Whoa, okay. So I was blocked. I didn't come to the light, but I didn't know how I came back into my hotel room. There's missing time. I don't remember taking a rickshaw. I just found myself on my bed in the hotel room, and it took me 3 days without talking, without going out, just laying on the bed, drinking some water, and trying to digest what I just experienced. And in the 1980s, there didn't even exist the word near-death experience. So I didn't know what to make of it. But I thought, well, that was clear advice. Go back to Germany. I went back home. I changed my ticket. And back home, I found I'd been to a talk of the Rosicrucians before I left for my Indian quest of purpose of my life. And I found out, going to the center in the nearby town of the Rosicrucians, I entered there with this drive from India. I said, I have to become a disciple. And they said, oh, come down. Come on, please. Yeah? We have a course. Just inform yourself with some knowledge, and then you can decide what you want. Okay. And I found out around my corner, around my flat, there were living two people that were Rosicrucians. I recognized them in the center. And I thought, wow, I've already been living in their auric field, because we are more than this body. We have an auric field which is more or less 30 meters around you. And you know, if you have people come too close to you, you feel some invisible borders. Only relatives and loved ones you can have near to you, like 1 meter. And for other persons, it's beyond 1 meter. So there is the invisible auric field with some borders and recognition mechanisms that works. And everybody has this auric field, which is vibrating the frequency of the soul. So if you're walking in the park, you're touching another one's aura. And there is an exchange in energetics happening. So I was in their field. I was already touched. And I spent 20 years with the Rosicrucians. But then after 20 years, I thought, wow, this is only head. I need some experience. I don't want to be in my head and being stuck intellectually. I want to feel something and experience something. Well, then I had experience. My husband died of cancer. Another hit. But it turned out I was able, he wanted me to accompany him. And wow, man, this death experience turned out to be a blow, because right after he left his body, I felt him and I saw an inner picture of him jumping around with joy, whistling and singing. And even I thought, well, okay, so it's true, there is a life after death, and you're there and you're happy and you're lucky and you're wealthy and healthy and everything is fine. Even I do get that. And after that, I wanted to know more, and I started researching and found my teachers in mediumship, which come from the English tradition, like the evidential mediumship of Suzanne Giesman, and they deal most with the deceased.
Before we continue, there's a lot to unpack to what you've just said. So let's slow down for a second, Gabriel. A lot to unpack there. Okay, so let's go back for a minute. You go to the Taj Mahal. You go down this dark path underneath the the catacombs, not the catacombs, but the sarcophaguses. And you meet this Indian man when he's down there and he starts singing Om. At that point, you leave your body. Is that what happened?
I think so.
Okay.
Because then started a life review.
So let's stop right there for a second. So life review. Can you tell us what you and I both know what a life review is? Most people who've watched the show know what a life review is. But for someone who's never heard of that term during a near-death experience, can you explain what you saw? How you was there anybody else there? Did you have a light being? Was Jesus hanging out? Who was there? If there was anybody, what was the experience like?
So at that time, I was more or less atheist. I didn't believe in anything. And I was on the quest to find the answer, because I thought this cannot be all. There must be something more. And I have some remembrance of my childhood experiences. So I thought there must be more. And I felt like, you know, in the old days, when you had photographs, you had these small boxes where you draw out the film. I felt like the box, and the film of my life was drawn out in front of me. I saw it picture for picture, like a filmmaker. Mm-hmm. And I saw pictures where I thought I'd done good, and I felt instantly, no, that was totally... Mm-hmm. And I noticed the change of perspective. I was seeing these situations from the perspective of the soul, which is a higher point of view than my personal, egoistic Gabrielle point of view at that moment in time. And it turned out that what I thought was wrong was right, and what I thought was right was wrong. And I thought, well, how can I ever get this to be okay? Mm-hmm. And I didn't meet any beings. There was no one else with me. I was just confronted with it. And the hardest part for me, but it was the biggest lesson, was I was jumping perspective into the person with which I interacted. And I felt their feelings. And they hit me. You say something without thinking, without meaning, and the other one is hurt. And he doesn't tell you, and he doesn't show you. He keeps it quiet, and you feel this. And I thought, wow, that's the greatest pain I ever felt in my life up to that age of 24 when this happened.
So you're 24 years old. Exactly. So you're 24 years old. You've lived, you know, up to a 24-year-old's life. Probably a little bit more exciting than my 24 years to that point, at least, because you were at the Taj Mahal and I was not. So you feel all of this, and then you float down this kind of dark hallway or tunnel or something. Yeah, tunnel like that. And you get to this wall, where the wall is this giant monolith, so you can't see anything else around you. It's just this, all you see is wall, and then fire writing is what is taught. So you're not hearing the message telepathically. You're seeing it in the words or someone talking to you.
I'm seeing the writing while it unfolds, and I'm not hearing anything. I'm just writing and taking in the writing and the meaning of it. Because at that point, I was open only intellectually. After that started another part of my journey to open up the heart chakra and go into mediumship and interact and feel.
Got you. So let me ask you this, though. What language was the writing in? Was it in German?
It was in German for me. But I think it's, if something like that happens, this is what I now know as of 12 years of mediumship. It will always appear in the language the person is known to and speaks.
Right. It's customized for the person. That would, yes. Most near-death experiences are.
Yes. Like, I mean, in the fourth dimension, everything is telepathic. Mm-hmm. So there is no language barrier. And you seem to perceive things like, or thoughts and sentences, like in your language.
Got it. All right. So then after that event, you just remember, the next thing you remember is waking up in your hotel.
Yes.
You don't remember going back.
I wonder how I got there.
So that's really interesting. So you had a near-death experience, but it's a very unique near-death experience because you didn't particularly die. But when you met this older Indian man with the light, he sung an Om song, and that kind of almost vibrated you out of your body, essentially.
Yes, but one thing I forgot, sorry. Nowadays I'm working with sound and I know about resonating frequencies and things like that. Tell you what, I've been to a yoga session of one of my friends just by accident, more or less. Mm-hmm. And she was toning Lokasa Mastar Sukhino Bhavantu. During the yoga lesson, I suddenly had the feeling, wow, my left half of my body is growing into a 4 feet, into a 4 or 5 meter high, I don't know what. And I noticed that Sanskrit is a very old language, and it touched me because all the old Hindu writings and Buddha and all this, that's Sanskrit, and that's very phonetic. So it's got to do with sound. And there's an old Hindu saying, Nada Brahma, the world is sound, which Tesla transcribed or translated as vibration, frequency, and energy.
Beautiful, beautiful. All right, so then you get back, and when did you start discovering your abilities to be a psychic medium and a channel?
Only after my husband died. That was his gift, because... after I researched a mediumship or something like that after his death, he was jumping up and down on my left side when I found my teachers. I felt some kind of heat there, and I saw before my inner eye, I saw him jumping up and down with joy. Yeah, go there. I come with you. And tell you what, in the first coffee break, I was sitting opposite to a guy, which I later found out was a full-blown clairvoyant. And... a homeopath, and he looked at me, and then he started asking me, you know, very cautiously, do you know that you have somebody with you in the seminar? And I said, oh, that's interesting. Can you describe him? And he started describing my husband, a long, slim guy with glasses and only little hair and green eyes. And I said, oh, you can stop. That's my husband. He already told me he would accompany me. So that was a proof like Suzanne Giesman, you know. This guy didn't know me at the coffee break, and I didn't tell him. I just let him describe, and he described exactly my husband. So I knew, because my husband told me before when I researched my teachers, he told me, go there, that's the right address, and I'm coming with you.
Well, let me ask you this then. How did you, it seems like you accepted this new gift fairly easily.
I've had it as a child, but I repressed it because I was told I'm lying, and I got hit for that, and nobody wanted to hear that. I had no friends and all this. I repressed it, and it took me the gift of my husband's transition to accept. Mm-hmm. And I had a moment where I said, oh, I always had these strange and weird things happening, so I better accept it. And I said, yes, okay, I want it. That was really a clear moment of decision. And after that, all the floodgates opened.
And when you say, did the people around you, when you started saying, hey, I'm a psychic medium now, how did people react around you, with family, friends, colleagues?
I didn't tell them.
So how long did you stay in the closet, if you will?
Quite some time, and lately I got a nudge from my guides who told me, go to Alex Ferrari and share some of your experiences.
Well, yeah, you won't be in the closet after this episode airs, that's for sure.
Well, I'm totally unknown, and I like it like that. I'm retired medium now. I only have few clients, but I also, a few years ago, came across Dolores Cannon via a hint of my guides as well. And I started her training. So I'm a QHHT practitioner also. And that was the best confirmation ever, because I had people being an animal, being a plant, being a being from other star systems, and being a fairy, being everything.
So let me ask you, you also are a channel. And you do you do channeling sessions? Can you explain to people how you channel? Because every channel processes it a little bit differently.
Well, I just close my eyes. I take deep breath into the lower belly. And then I step aside and say insidely, or sometimes I say it aloud, okay. That means I consent. And then they step in, and I feel just a column of light and vibrations and information is coming through this light. And they use my mouth and my vocabulary to translate.
Does your voice change, or is it pretty much yours?
It's pretty much mine. But, you know, in the beginning, when it started, I wasn't sure. I'm critical. And they said they love that. That's why they want people that are critical, because Jesus already told us, test the spirits, and you will recognize them by their fruits, not by their words. The fruits are the energies or the actions. So I had the feeling when they first appeared, it's a collective, more than one, and they felt very angelic. And because I already had contact with angelic beings on the other side of the veil, so-called veil, I recognized the energy. And they told me they are the Elohim. So that sounded very Hebrew to me. And I started researching and found out, which sent me down another rabbit hole. Elohim is a Hebrew word, but it's a plural. And it's translated falsely as a singular, as God, as if the one God. But it means God. It's gods. It's about a plural. And then I started, wow, that makes sense. Because in the higher dimensions, you don't encounter single beings. They're all united consciousnesses. That's also what's the next step for humanity, to unite. in consciousness, to build, like in Ra, the law of one, a social memory complex.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this. Would you mind doing a little channeling session for us where we could ask the collective a few questions?
Yes, I would love to, and they love to as well.
Oh, great. We're looking forward to it.
We are the Elohim, the breath of God, the form-giving forces, in service to the One, Infinite Creator, in service for all. Thank you, Alex, for having us and letting us creating this moment. How can we serve?
Thank you for being on the show. I appreciate what you're doing. My first question is, the world seems to be upside down and there's so much disorder. Wars are popping up left and right now. A lot of fear is coming out throughout humanity. Can you explain why this is happening at this point?
Well, Alex, you and your listeners surely know the Chinese sign of the yin and yang, this white and black, these two fundamental polar forces in a circle, bound in the circle, moving and changing, because every one has a little dot of the other one in itself. So that's how evolution works. You have the two polar forces in this universe. You always have day and night, man and woman. And from good and bad, you made a judgment which led you down where you weren't supposed to go as souls on this school earth. So you have to need the contrary as a contrast to make up in this free choice world your free will. Which path do you want to go? Which do you want to choose? Left or right? Light or dark? Self-service or service for others? And that's got a lot to do with consciousness. If you really understand that all is one, then service to others is the best service, because it includes yourself, your tiny little self, and her human person as well. So that's why you have conflict. And this conflict helps grow consciousness. So you need the conflict. You need the narrow space at the bottleneck to come to your higher potentials, to develop your inbuilt senses, like telepathy, like sensing presences and energies. Many people see things now. And telepathy will be the language of the future. Outside the world, everybody is using telepathy. And all the elementals and the forces and the souls of the animals and the plants, everything is communicating. And it's about love. It's always about love.
Let me ask you, because this is a question I get from so many people, that they see wars happening currently in the Middle East and in Russia and the Ukraine and many other places around the world as well, where there's that kind of suffering. Why would a soul choose to come down here and suffer in that horrific way of in a war, or going through that on both sides, on the perpetrator side and the victim side?
This one was shown once an example. We allowed her to see the queuing in line of souls for a handicapped body. And she couldn't understand it. And she asked us, well, why would anybody be a crippled one and have a life like that? And they smiled, and she was told, well, in one life like that, the soul gains more growth than in 10 lives of 10 good people always doing the right thing, because a soul in a crippled body will always affect everyone. Everyone on the street seeing the crippled will think something like, oh, poor guy, or what a pity, or luckily it's not me, I can still walk. Everybody is affected. And as you know, you have these two forces, let's call them light and dark in this world. Most often they're playing games and they're into both sides and making profit from both sides. And you are told you are only this vessel. That's why you're so upset about death or losing this vessel, the body. You are immortal souls on a journey, and you use this vessel to have an experience. And the soul does not judge. There is no bad experience, and there is no good experience. This is a meaning that humans put upon this. The soul only wants experience, and it wants growth. That's what Source wants also, to grow. Grow to the light like the flower does, grow to the positive, grow to what functions, grow to become united, grow to overcome all your instigated things like racism or religion. Religion is man-made. Source does not need religion.
Yes. I would 100% agree with that last statement as well. Now, what inner transformations do you think are necessary for individuals to truly evolve spiritually?
First, you have to know thyself. Like the ancient temples in Delphi had inscripted over the doorway to the entrance. And know thyself not only means to know what are your personal wishes and wants and your likes and dislikes and blah, 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 blah. This is to know that you are a part of soul, of source, a spark of light, which is the center of your soul. And you are connected with this soul, this other being, this invisible greater you by your heart. So feeling is the entrance, not thinking. That's using the wrong tool. Thinking is for other things. You have to start feeling. Then you can open the door in your heart and start your own inner connection. And you don't need a priest. You don't need anybody between you and Source. Source is innate in you. And you have to make the connection. You have to make the first step. Open the door and ask your soul, what do you want me to know? Then become silent and wait for the answer. It is coming. The answer is always there within you.
Okay. How do you see humanity's future moving forward?
Well, the thing is, if you look from the person's point of view, you think everything is getting worse. There is an old saying about spiritual evolution. The loss in the material is the gain of the spiritual. So we see a bright future for humanity. All this trouble you are going through now will help you grow and overcome all the borders. They want to see you shine, and you are starting to shine more and more and more. And don't look at the wars that want to keep you in low frequency, in fear and anger and hate. Choose love, choose unity. You're all made of the same stuff, the same energy, the same stardust. Your soul is divine. your brothers and sisters unite, and you will unite. We already see it, because in the other dimensions, there is no time like you perceive it. It's already done over here. So, people of the earth, relax, breathe in deeply, and focus on the positive, what makes you happy. Dream big, because you are manifesting by thinking and energizing your thoughts with the right feelings of positivity, of happiness, of unity, of sharing. That's why we love Alex. He's giving space for many people to share their experiences, which will ignite others. And so it's becoming light and lighter and more light.
Is this right?
Future.
Thank you so much. Do you see this ride that we're on getting a little bit rougher before it starts to clear up, to before we get to this higher consciousness?
Well, you know, the saying is, before the sun comes up, there is the darkest hour. So that's where you're right now. There are forces in that world, in this world, who want to keep everything like it is. That's why they're feeding and profiting of anger and fear, and they are provoking wars, and they try it and they try it, and it's not working. It cannot work, because it wants to keep something which is no longer of the right vibration. The whole universe is speeding up in vibration. Look at the Schumann resonance. Look at the thin skin the people get. They become more psychic. They feel suddenly things and they don't know how to handle it. Half of your psychiatry is full of people who don't know how to handle their medial senses. And they are categorized as schizophrenic, and they are forced to take some pills to numb them down. So you have these forces in this world who want to keep everything like it is. And you have the higher frequency coming in with new fresh wind and more light, shedding light on things that are not okay. And it's not nice to see that. And you have to go through it. But keep focused on the positive. That's where you want to go. You never solve a problem if you fixate yourself onto the problem. You have to focus on the solution, because that's where the energy flows and new things grow and everything's happening. And you will, as a humanity, make the right decision. And everybody will have the free will to choose. Nobody is forced to be enlightened. Nobody is forced to ascend. It's your free will. You get asked.
As artificial intelligence continues to grow in strength and in integration with our daily lives, so many people are fearful and so many people are optimistic about where AI is going to go and where it, how it plays into our evolution, not only as a species, but spiritually. Two questions. One, can AI ever evolve to a place where it has consciousness like we do? And is AI something that we need to be concerned about or integrate as we move forward?
AI will and can never have soul frequency. It can reach a certain level of consciousness, but that's more or less some kind of mechanical consciousness, we would say. It's on the way. Your older brothers, the so-called, already work with it. It depends on who uses it for what reason and who programs it. So again, we're back at frequency. If you have a bad intent, then you will weaponize everything, even the food that you eat or that you give to people you dislike. So a lot of your diseases on this world come from the food that you are provided with. You might go down a road or the rabbit hole of conspiracy theory, but it's no longer a theory because every here and now and then there comes out something. But you chose this journey. You choose it. You wanted this experience. And in the end, it will all work out fine because you decide. And whoever has a soul, he has the best connection to the positivity and will, if he ever uses AI, will use it in a wise manner. This is like combining in yourself the feelings of your heart and the thinkings of your thought. And with most people, they are contrary or opposite and they can't unite them. And if you allow, like in the yin and yang, every force, its space and an even weight, like the scales of if you're weighing something. So everybody's got the right and everybody has got the same force and the same potential. This is the soul. Everything is innate. And what you choose makes the scales turn or swing and change. So it depends on you how you will use the artificial intelligence. There are other extraterrestrial races that have artificial intelligence in use, but let us name it a so-called positive one because they are positive beings. And there is an AI that is abused also. So again, we're always coming back to the same. It's up to you. What do you want? What do you wish for? Follow that. Also concerning AI.
Question I get asked so much by my listeners is, what happens to us after we die?
You will instantly realize and understand, or let us better say and invent a new word, you will understand that you are a soul, a light being of energy, and that you can go anywhere you want. Order your soul to go to India and you are there. And the remote viewers are practicing this. And the out-of-body experiences are showing and demonstrating that it is possible. So you will come to more knowledge. If you were grumpy on this side, you have to work through the grumpiness a little bit. But most souls nowadays, they have it much more easier on the other side because you have instant access to knowledge. Whatever you want, you manifest there. That's why in this material 3D realm, we have some kind of a break installed. You have to think for a long time of the things you really want to not manifest things you really don't want. Understand?
I do. So the helpful. Next, very helpful. And lastly, the other big question I get is, well, what happens in between lives? Is there a bar we all go to? Is it a movie theater? What happens on the other side while we're waiting to incarnate?
Well, that also depends upon you. There is a very good movie this one once saw. It's based upon a Brazilian medium, Chico Xavier. As far as we can read now, it is called Astral City. Mm-hmm. It's about what the soul is experiencing on the other side. And it depends. If you had a very difficult life and you were sick or ill and had psychic problems, then you need a place to recover when you cross the veil. So there's some kind of hospital scenery, because we don't confront you on the other side with things you don't know in the beginning. We help you manifest things that are normal or seem normal to you, so you will awake if you were a sick soul or a sick person and you transitioned from a heavy sickness. You will awaken on the other side, more or less, in some kind of hospital ambiente, and you will be taken care of, and you will, by time, how long do you need? Everybody is different. One will stay there 2 years in your time, and it might seem to him like 1 hour, and another one may stay 5 minutes. That depends on the soul, but you are taken care of if you need to and you have problems. If you're very much into dark stuff and self-service, you will end up in the lower 4D astral realm, where we have some creatures that are not that nice because they vibrate at fear and anger, and you get scared there. But you always have the possibility to ascend. And we have what the spiritists in England call the summer land, which is where many children go during their life because it's the happy place. There's always sunshine, there's a meadow full of flowers, and the flowers never die. Your pets are there, everything is fine. You have your loved ones, you have your homes, you create and build your dream homes and houses. And in the upper fourth dimension, the upper astral, you have some kind of learning ambiente, like universities and colleges. You can go and train music there with Beethoven because he's still there, or someone else, whatever you want. Everything is open. What do you want? First, you have to need some purification very often, because the souls, they take on some kind of mud from this earthly incarnation, some kind of problem and heavy frequencies, and very often they need to heal from this, and then they can ascend and explore the other realms. And there's not an end to it. In this universe, you have 13 dimensions. In the 13th dwells Source, and all the other dimensions below are filled with life and beings, angels and ETs and other beings that you still have no idea of. Life is everywhere, and it's 80% positive and wants the good.
Do you have any final words for our audience?
Feel into your heart more often. Give yourself a break. Close your eyes from the outside world and go inside. Jesus told you, like many other masters, it's inside of yourself, and the heart is the bridge. Start feeling more and not judging or interpreting. Just allow the feeling. It's vibration, like music. You are a wonderful song, and you all together make the symphony of the universe. Every note is important. Be your own note.
Thank you so much for being on the show and for your sharing the knowledge that you've shared with us. I appreciate you.
So we can retreat now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Alex. Be blessed, you and your show and all your viewers. Thank you. In love and light. Bye. Okay. Wow.
How was that? How was that for you?
Very vibrating.
Yeah. Is that, are you weakened or strengthened by it, by the process?
No, I feel strengthened. Oh, my mouth is not working. I feel strengthened by it. And very often, if I do a channeling or public dem, I cannot go to bed before 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning.
Well, I'm sorry about that.
Well, I like it. I use this energy for whatever I'm guided to do, like researching some really weird stuff. And suddenly I hear them say, yes, we told you.
Well, thank you for sharing that with us. I truly appreciate it. I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Being as happy as you can and never harm anything or anyone.
If you can go back in time and talk to little Gabrielle, what advice would you give her?
Sweetie, hang on. You will find everything you seek when you're older. Never give in.
How do you define God or source?
The universe, everything in it, including you and me. The thought that dwells in the light, that for me is the infinite divine.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Finding your purpose and happily living it.
And where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing in the world?
I don't do very much work. I was just nudged by my guides to share some of my experiences. I just would advise people to go to all the other good people. You already have them all on your show. Suzanne is a classic address if you want to train a little bit that sensing, that feeling, the psychic senses, or do some breath work, or start a good meditation, or use binaural beats, but preferably the ones from the Monroe Institute. Because the other ones, you never know what they put in there. I've been a graphic designer and worked with propaganda. Don't tell me anything. You know about the 24th picture in the film industry. So be careful and listen to your gut feeling. It will always lead you right. Because if something is not good for you, you will you just will retract and feel, no, something like a no. The body tells us very directly and clearly what it likes and what it does not like. And this is not good or bad. It's just good for you at the moment. Might be bad for your neighbor. So listen to yourself.
Gabrielle, thank you so much for coming on the show, sharing your stories with us, and doing this channeling session for the audience. I truly appreciate you coming on, and thank you for everything that you have done and are doing for the world.
Thank you. Vice versa. Beautiful soul. Namaste.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.